Give me a sign. Are you good to go? Well, thank you everybody for coming along today. We are delighted to have, through the sponsorship of Lallemand, the ability to bring in some speakers. And obviously today we brought along Mike Cheer. For those of you who don't know Mike, Mike's been a commercial brewer for how long now?
6 years.
6 years, originally in Harrington's, in Christchurch. They're moving up to Steam Brewing in Auckland, and then adding the international brewing consultant tag to your name with a stint out in Samoa, and now brewing at Volstead down in Christchurch. So we brought Mike along today to talk specifically about dry hop creep and how to avoid it. This is a subject that's important to Mike because he has been dedicated for a while of trying to make sure that the dreaded D, diacetyl, is less prevalent in beers. So we will get straight into it. Over to you, Mike. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mike, and thanks, League of Brewers, and Eddyline as well.
Just need to talk loud.
Loud, okay,
loud.
Cool.
Loud is good.
And thanks, Lallemand, as well. So, I'm here to talk about diacetyl again. It seems to be my main talking point. Just for clarification, who's seen me talk about diacetyl before? Okay, so not everyone, which is good. So I'll go over a few things again. It seems to be what I always talk about at these events, but that's fine because I hate it, so it must be removed. So how many of you have heard about dry hop creep before hearing about this talk? So, 1, 2, 3, yeah, about... Yeah, maybe 2/3. Okay, cool. So don't feel bad because it's only been like sort of officially recognized maybe in the last few years. It's actually something the brewers have been working against for quite a while, in fact. It turns out over 100 years. So we'll get into that in a minute. But essentially, dry hop creep refers to the creep of fermentation that happens after doing big dry hops. And it's something that's been quite poorly understood, at least in the New Zealand industry. But what can happen is, essentially, the dry hop can cause more attenuation in the late ferment stage, which, of course, as any fermentation does, creates diacetyl and other fermentation byproducts. Then these fermentation byproducts are not given enough time to reabsorb, and the beer is packaged, and then diacetyl manifests in the package, whether that be keg or bottle or whatever. So obviously something that is quite a significant problem, and perhaps has mainly raised its head lately because of the influx of big dry hopped hazy beers and extremely heavily hopped like American IPAs, right? So we're talking dry hops, which are sometimes in excess of 20 grams a litre, sometimes even as high as 40 or 50 grams a litre. And it is not, that's not to say that you can't get dry hop creep at lower dry hop levels, like 6 to 10, which would sort of be your sort of standard IPA, I guess, dry hop level. But it certainly exacerbates it when you have these really, really high levels of dry hop, which especially hazy East Coast IPAs tend to have. Okay, so like I said, dry hop creep is something that perhaps has only really come into mainstream consciousness in the last maybe 2 years. But it's actually been known about since at least 1893. So in England, you're all familiar with cask ale and how cask ale works. I know particularly this man is. Basically what would happen in cask ale is generally IPAs would be cask hopped. So they would be hopped in the fermenter, and then when they're transferred to the cask, which is the final serving vessel, which has yeast in it, so cask condition naturally carbonated, they would again dry hop in the cask. And this would help to preserve, and key, they would use the term freshen the beer. Now, these brewers were expecting in the cask to get an extra 0.2 specific gravity fermentation, which would create the carbonation in the cask, and also they sort of felt that it would dry out the beer a little bit and make the beer ready for service. Now, for those of you familiar with British IPAs, you know that in the BJCP style guideline, it states that diacetyl is actually acceptable at very low levels. That doesn't mean that it has to be there, but it can be acceptable. And this is, I think, partially because of this phenomenon. Because when they would dry hop in the cask with the yeast present, the hops would create sugars that would be able to be attenuated, and then the diacetyl would not be reabsorbed, and then you would end up with the dry hop creep. So In 1893, Brown and Morris wrote a paper on certain functions of hop used in the dry hopping of beers. So this is over 100 years ago. And the first line of this is, we are now in a position to ascertain how far the sugars of the hop are accountable for the after-fermentation induced of dry hopping. So that's specifically referring to after-fermentation that is induced by dry hopping. Now, before I was a brewer, I was a historian. So imagine my joy of finding a primary source from the British cask ale of 1893, which I could actually read. And in fact, even though it says how far the sugars of the hop, it seems like they're saying that, oh, they're explaining it by saying hops have sugar. These are not idiots, these are scientists. And even though they're scientists 100 years ago, they say in the paper that clearly hops do not contain sugar. So their next step was to ascertain whether or not the hops were harbouring any microbiota, like a wild yeast or something like that, or bacteria that might contribute to this over-attenuation. And these are very familiar scientists with characteristics of wild yeast. For example, Brettanomyces was discovered in British cask ale. That's why it's called Brettanomyces, basically English yeast, essentially. So they knew it wasn't wild yeast because it didn't taste strange or sour, or there wasn't any non-standard fermentation characteristics there. So they concluded, or rather the last option that they kind of left hanging, was that the hops must contain some kind of enzyme that can transform non-fermentable sugars in the beer, which has already been fermented to the yeast by the yeast, into fermentable sugars in a similar manner to how it occurs in the mash at cask temperature. And then these freed sugars are then consumed by the yeast, which creates a second fermentation. And they stated this in 1893 in this paper. So I'm actually a huge fan of the terminology sugar in the hop, because this kind of speaks to me of how I used to think about this phenomenon. I knew that it occurred. I could see that one or two points of specific gravity were being freed up by heavy dry hopping in IPAs, etc. And I could see that this was then undergoing a later fermentation well after the initial fermentation. I knew it was occurring. I put it down to the fact that the addition of the hops was mixing the fermenter, creating some kind of agitation that would revitalize the yeast. I also put it down to perhaps the presence of yeast nutrients and trace amounts in the hops, that the yeast were they were being revitalized by the hops in some way. And the other thing that I thought was, and this is a fact, that yeast will stick to hop particles when they're in suspension. And I thought that this might allow the yeast to stay in suspension longer and then just take up that extra one or two points. But it's a definite fact, if you've worked in breweries and you see enough fermentations, that fermentations that get dry hopped heavily will always dry out more. And again, I mainly put this down to the agitation step. It turns out that brewers from Bell's Brewing, the science team there, back in 2011 were actually doing research on this, because their brewery was going through an expansion and they were coming under more heavy scrutiny from the US government about alcohol levels. And they were finding that, you know, their alcohol levels on their dry hop beers were always coming out in like 0.5% higher than their other beers, sometimes enough to bring it out of spec from their liquor license, the excise tax. So they looked into this phenomenon, and they initially came to the same conclusion I did, that it was because of the mixing of the hops, and quickly kind of did a few experiments on the lab tabletop and with agitators, etc., and eventually found out that no, it's actually enzymes in the hops. And what they found was that Google is our friend as brewers. How many of you have Googled something the day before a brew, right? In fact, I did that yesterday before I did this brew this morning. But Google had actually archived hundreds of years of brewing documents, which were out of copyright, and this document was part of it. So these brewers simply typed into Google something like dry hop diastase or something to do with enzymatic hops. And this paper showed up and they read it, much like I did. Although, in my case, after I read the article where the brewers were talking about it. Realized that enzymes were a potential. And now, 100 years later, we have the ability to test for these enzymes. So the enzyme test kits that we have available today are more geared towards malt, which has much, much higher levels of these enzymes than does hops. But they were able to use a similar testing methodology. And you've got to remember that these breweries have, at times, hundreds of staff and usually like PhDs like in their science team of this brewery. So you're talking like big American craft brewers, right? And they just basically did it was Allagash and Bell's collaborated with funding from the US government to research this. And this is only in 2013, 14 you're talking now. They proved that the hops did include, were adding enzymes to the beer, that the yeast was then re-fermenting the freed up sugars, and that this was causing issues, including but not limited to overcarbonation in package, diacetyl spikes above threshold, and sometimes turbidity as well. Haze. They actually published something, I think. I don't have it here with me. But consider the similarity like between something like a 19th century cask ale and an East Coast IPA. So again, this is what these guys are talking about English IPAs in cask. So for hundreds of years, for the 100 years between 1893 and 2011, most beer had been probably either filtered or pasteurized, at least after the Second World War. Mass market lagers, so this wasn't an issue. Suddenly in the 90s, people started really using hops in a big way again, right? But they were still filtering, and often they'll be using pad sterile filtration to get a clear beer. And it's maybe only in the last 20 years that we've really seen the rise of unfiltered beers, and now specifically hazy. People are looking for this big, big haze craze. So if you look at a 19th century cask IPA, it probably wouldn't have been super clear. It would have had both yeast and hop matter in the cask, very similar to an East Coast IPA. They both often would use lower attenuating and higher diacetyl producing English strains. For example, London Ale 3 is very common for use in hazy IPAs, and London Ale 3 or some variation of it would have been very similar to the yeast strains that would have been used back in the early 20th century. They often have a higher finishing gravity on account of the fact that these yeasts are usually low attenuating, and they're often a bit maybe higher mashed than, say, your American IPAs. So there's residual sugar there, but it's not fermentable by the yeast. So that, but it's potential sugar that then the yeast, so the hops, are going in and attacking, right? And then consider similarities between these two things, so English cask IPA and East Coast IPA, and homebrewers. So homebrewers are often dry hopping heavily. They usually can't filter or don't filter. They're certainly not pasteurizing. Not the hoppy beers anyway, maybe some sour brewers are. But this is a very similar kind of process environment that we're talking about here. These three kind of things. And it made me think, even when I was a home brewer, I was like, what is this extra fermentation that I'm getting? Why do my hops taste slightly sweet and buttery on my big dry hop beers? And like, what phenomenon is it? And I put it down to, at times, hop variety choice, temperature of the dry hop, and then eventually started to suspect that it was actually diacetyl, because I could taste diacetyl in the beer. I knew I'd given it a good diacetyl rest. I knew that beers that I had done the same profile with the same yeast that didn't get dry hopped were diacetyl free, and I started to suspect that it was something to do with the hops. So my early impressions were, in commercial breweries, you tend to get a very clean hop flavour from a filtered IPA. So there's a difference between someone doing, say, like a panhead IPA clone at home, where they make it in the grandfather or whatever, transfer it to the keg unfiltered. That's always going to taste a bit grassier and perhaps muddled than the hop flavour from, say, panhead brewery itself, where it might be centrifuged and then de-filtered. And what's happening there is you're removing the vegetal notes of the hop, but you're leaving the oils and the actual fruity flavors. So when you pull those vegetal notes out, you actually allow the tropical, passion fruity, you know, variety, like tasting notes of those hops to really shine. But what if the leaving of the hops and the yeast into the keg was actually causing a small amount of diacetyl to manifest from this heavy dry hop because of the enzymes causing a little bit more extra fermentation? I had many what I would call just threshold deep moments in homebrew where I could taste it, but no one else could taste it, and they were like, you're taking the piss. Like, or you're overly sensitive, and I'm like, no, it's there, it's just you're not perceiving it as diacetyl because it's muddled in with all of that dry hop character. And but if it wasn't there, the dry hop character would be much cleaner. What it's done is it's made the dry hop character appear sweeter and generally more kind of fruit bowly, tropical. So you would have a beer that was dry hopped 100% Centennial or 100% US Cascade, some American hop that wasn't Sauvigny or fruit bowly at all. And this little amount of diacetyl made the whole thing feel softer and sweeter and more like, I guess, diesel-y, which shouldn't be characteristics of that hop. But what you were finding was it would create a more of a tropical flavour from a piney flavour, because you're mixing like sweetness and very low levels of caramel with citrus flavours, and that was giving you more of a mango-y kind of tropical taste. And I found it very hard to define this for a very long time. Because usually dry hop creek diacetyl is very, very low threshold, so it's like just above threshold, and it's masked by massive amounts of hops, because it always occurs in beers which have large amounts of hops, usually 6 grams a litre plus. And so what it's actually doing is it's affecting the hop profile. It may not be noticeable as actual D, maybe most half of the time, it will be under threshold for people to be like, that's a D-bomb. That's not the issue, it's the fact that it is in there at a level that is too high, but it's changing the hop character from something that's fresh and punchy and maybe citrusy or you know, like vibrant, it's turning it into something that's softer and more sweet and like just doesn't have the punch through. So it's taking the edge off the fresh hop character, which is a big issue if you're a commercial brewer, but maybe a home brewer might not notice it. So from discussion with other brewers, and I won't name them, but there was one in particular up north when I was in Auckland that I had a really good conversation about this, and they said basically they noticed this and they didn't know what it was for years, but the character would change in the can, so the diacetyl would manifest itself. And those of you who remember my other talks, diacetyl is actually starts off as acetolactate, alpha acetolactate, which is tasteless, and then through oxidation becomes diacetyl, and after it becomes diacetyl, it can be reabsorbed by the yeast. So if you put a beer in package that has this tasteless precursor in it, that is alpha acetolactate, you won't be able to taste it in the brewery until you either do a heat test, so you stir it up, heat it up, and then it will manifest through oxidation, or it comes out in the package. So the problem with having yeast in the package as well as hop matter is that the hop matter is causing these enzymatic reactions, creating free sugars, which the yeast then eats at maybe a lower temperature than it would in ferment, and then creates that diacetyl, which it then can't reabsorb. And then this dry hop just tastes slightly too sweet and cloying, and not the fresh kind of punchy thing that we wanted. And they were like, so we just tried once. We dry hopped at 10-20 at gravity instead of finishing gravity, and the dry hops were so much cleaner. And initially, he's like, I put it down to biotransformation. He was like, I put it down to biotransformation, creating a more fruity flavour. But no, it was like, actually, it was, we ran the beers side by side through gastrometer F-tests, and one came back with just above threshold diacetyl, and the other one didn't. So the one that had been dry hopped during fermentation did not have the same diacetyl levels. And the reason that is because the enzyme actions are actually happening during active primary ferment, which is then just treating the diacetyl like any other diacetyl that's created in primary ferment and dealing with it then, rather than what happens is that the yeast drops out and then can't deal with it later. I'll get to that in a bit. This underscores the importance of testing your gravities every day. especially if you're making some kind of change to the beer, like you're moving it from one vessel to another, you're dry hopping it, you're adding anything to it, you want to be checking your gravities daily, which is hard for home brewers because generally you're taking this much beer out of this much beer. For us, it's that much beer and that's fine. But you can always use your refractometer with a back calculation to figure out against the alcohol difference, so you can do that. We would always observe these drops post-dry hop, usually 1 to 2 SG points, which is enough to give you, you know, extra half a point or more of alcohol, and extra carbonation as well, which is an issue for home brewers. How many of you guys have heard of diastaticus yeast strains, mainly Saison? Yeah. So there was a big incident recently where White Labs had to come clean about some of their Saison strains containing diastaticus, which is essentially a yeast that can do the same things that these hops can. So they can change, they can do the same thing that happens in the mash. They can enzymatically transform, free up sugars for themselves to eat. So this is an evolutionary thing that these yeasts have developed, in that they can take something like maltotriose, for example, which might not necessarily be simple enough for them to eat, and they can tear it down to maltose through their own enzymatic pathways, eat it, and then create alcohol and carbonation and diacetyl, like we all know. So at the round, this is about 3 years ago, 2 years ago this was coming out, I was thinking about dry hop creep, thinking about this diastaticus thing, and it all kind of came together with all of these things that got published, and it's sort of like, it's essentially the same thing. It's like, it's a mode of enzymatic transformation that we're not familiar with. We're like, only the mash can do that. Like, brewers control the mash. We control the spice. We control the universe. We're like, we love to imagine that we're like in control of this chaotic kind of set of environmental factors, but we're not. And these are only things that have really been discovered in the last 2 or 3 years. How many more things will we discover this in the next 5 or 10? So if yeast can do it, perhaps hops can as well. And it turns out they definitely can. So just quickly, I'll ask for any questions in that first section there. Is there anything, I talk a bit fast sometimes, so is there anything anyone missed or wanted to go over? Okay, I'm going to very quickly do my classic D talk. So what is diacetyl? So diacetyl is sort of like an artificial butterscotch taste, but it doesn't always manifest that way. So if you've tasted diacetyl in a controlled spike situation, that's not generally how it manifests. So in a hoppy beer, it can just simply taste like the person's added too much crystal malt, or they've under-attenuated by a couple of points, so it's a bit sweeter. So don't add too much crystal malt either. Essentially, depending on threshold, it'd be anywhere from this beer tastes like buttered popcorn, or this beer is a bit sweet, or even this beer isn't as hoppy as I expected. The last one was hoppier, or 3 days ago when I first kegged it, it was hoppier. Because what it does essentially is it mimics crystal malt or sweet flavors at low thresholds before.